Ludwig van Beethoven. Beethoven's music served as a model for the Romantic generation. The Romantics idolized him. He was their hero. While Beethoven's music was the fire that would light the way for these new composers, it was an Italian violin virtuoso who would ignite their imaginations and usher in a new age of piano playing.
Niccolò Paganini. He was quite possibly the world's first rock star. His talent on the violin was so otherworldly that some say that he sold his soul to the devil to achieve his talent. Audiences couldn't get enough of him. He sold out concert after concert. Everyone was amazed by the firework display of his virtuoso violin playing, including many young pianists like Robert and Clara Schumann, Franz Liszt, and Frédéric Chopin.
Now, piano music rivaled art songs as the most popular medium of the 19th century. Piano music had three overlapping purposes: teaching, amateur enjoyment, and public performances, specifically bravura pieces. Now, with bravura, the intent is to show off the skill of the performer. The first composer we'll be looking at is the influential Robert Schumann.
Robert Schumann was the first important composer of Lieder, or art songs, after Franz Schubert. In the year 1840, Schumann composed over 120 songs. That was also the year when he married an outstanding young virtuoso pianist named Clara Wieck. Schumann wanted to be a concert pianist, but he injured his hand, so he turned to composition and criticism, serving as the editor of the Neue Zeitschrift für Musik from 1834 to 1844, where he reviewed, at the time, relatively unknown composers like Chopin and later on Johannes Brahms. In his reviews, he opposed empty virtuosity and urged the study of older music. We'll be listening to two examples from Schumann's Carnival, Opus 9, which is a collection of character pieces for solo piano. In the music, Schumann imagines a masquerade ball in carnival season. Some of the guests, or the characters, at this made-up masquerade include Paganini and Chopin. Among the other guests are two characters Schumann used to embody different facets of his personality. Schumann used these two sides of his personality in his writing and his criticism. And those are the two movements we will look at from Carnival today: Florestan and Eusebius. Florestan is an impulsive revolutionary named after the hero from Beethoven's opera Fidelio. Eusebius is a visionary dreamer named after a 4th century pope. Now, think about the yin and the yang of these two personalities, the fiery, impulsive Florestan versus the whimsical visionary of Eusebius, because those two personalities will be heard in the music. In Eusebius, the music is dreamy and fantasy-like. Slow, not very dance-like, there's a chromatic bass under a curving melody in sextuplets. Florestan, again, fast and impassionate waltz, angular melodies, pulsating dissonances, and offbeat sforzandos. You may have noticed in both of the score excerpts the letters A, E, C, and H. This is Schumann's famous ash motive. The notes, actually, are A, E flat, C, and H, which is what they use for B natural in Germany. This motive has special meaning for Schumann, and I will give 2 extra credit points on Friday's listening quiz if you can tell me what the ash motive represents.
Schumann suffered from hallucinations in his later life. Some believe it was the result of mercury poisoning. He claimed to be haunted by a number of things, most notably the pitch A. He wrote extensively in his journals about how he constantly heard the note A, as if it were haunting him. Fearing for the safety of his wife, he was confined to an asylum at his own request, where he died in 1856. After Robert's death, Clara Schumann stopped composing and devoted herself entirely to promoting her husband's music. By playing only what was written, Clara Schumann focused the attention on the composer rather than the performer, a tradition that would carry over to Liszt and Chopin, a tradition that continues to this very day.